Well, welcome. My alarm just went off and it's 7 o'clock and we are here again for another session of Conscious Gatherers. And actually tonight we are back with our original four because our wandering spiritual host Donna is back with us. Welcome, Donna.
Thank you, Terry. And hello, everybody. Good to be back.
And besides Donna, as always, we have Royce, who gives us such a beautiful voice of wisdom, and Bev, whose channelings just come through very crystal clear. So we're in for a good treat tonight, and I'm sure we'll have a lot of discussion on whatever we bring up. So ladies, I'm going to turn it over to you.
All right. Well, welcome, everybody, to our episode 39. Today is April 6th, 2021, and a lot going on in this world, as we all noticed, and that continues, and what we're seeing within ourselves and seeing what we term the outer world, it's some pretty amazing going on right now. In fact, one thing I didn't talk about this last episode, but I had received the information about magnificent changes happening. And so know they are magnificent in a good way, if you want to use that word good. But I think it's a great way we're waking up. And yet we got to get through the muck. You know, the muck's got to go away for us to get there. And so we're seeing that, what's the right word, dichotomy or all this stuff that is going on. For us to realize we are the ones that are manifesting our lives, and it's that's why we're here to for everybody to understand that. So,
and it's a great time for us to use our creative imagination to put that to work. To, you know, what is it that you think is the ideal, the peaceful way to coexist? Imagine it. Use your creative imagination and. That's the first step in making a reality.
It's just, again, understanding how powerful each one of us is. If we want to see that change, we've got to do that and not get stuck into the fear and to really use the power that we are and the beauty that we are and the depth of who we are and to really understand that. So all the listeners, do not ever shortchange yourself, ever. I don't care what color, I don't care what creed, I don't care what sex you are, it doesn't matter. It's just loving yourself wholly, unconditionally, and if you want to make a change, you make a change, but it's up to you, and we're always making changes because we, you know, I don't know, we're, you know, that's our growth, if you want to call it growth, or understanding of ourselves on a much deeper level.
Yeah, on that note, too, about change and moving and creating yourself, I think we've got a societal stereotypical thing that all customs and certain customs, even more so than maybe here in the United States, but definitely still here in the United States. But it comes from way, way back in our history when just go even to medieval times. When you say you can't change your stars, meaning once you're born into your position, that's it, guys. You're not going to be a knight, or you know you're just going to be a stable boy, and we've carried that with us all along. All the cultures have carried it. In India, they have the caste system, and you know here we have middle class and lower class and upper class. Well, I'm here to tell you, and the other three ladies are here to tell you, no, that's not true. You can change your stars. There's, in fact, you are creating your stars. You're just not aware of it. And you're letting your environment and the people around you, the collective consciousness, to talk to you and stifling who and what you are. And you're buying into it. Don't buy into it. Don't buy into it. You can do anything you want and you can change your stars.
We are stars. Mm-hmm. I like that, Terry. And we are. You know, we are the stars in our beings. We're the star beings that came here to help this planet and help bring in the higher frequencies. So the more we remember that and, you know, create our reality as we know it, the highest that we see it and feel it,
and do that together and just don't get caught up in all the muckety muck. Because literally, I mean, the muckety muck is there to stifle people, and that's the purpose of it, basically. It's like the shadow side. So we don't have to get caught into it. We just keep creating and living in our freedom and our beauty and our love. Mm-hmm. And like Bev said, just loving ourselves and appreciating ourselves, and nobody out there, nothing on TV or radio or anywhere can influence us, because we are we and they are they. Really, we're all together, but, but we are we.
But it goes to the black and white type of thing, you know. You can see the dark side, if you want to use those words, and you can see the light side. So can you see the light without the dark? Would you even know what light is without the dark? And so we've developed, and we've talked about this on this program numerous times, but it's that we've developed this duality program, and man, we've said this so many times, but it sure as keeps playing itself out. And to me, it's getting more ridiculous, at least the way I see it. And it's like, wow, you know, so the narrative's out there, and a lot of us are kind of laughing at what that narrative is. And not get caught up in it, but to see it for what it is and what it is for you. Not everybody is going to see it the same way. I do understand that, because whatever they need to experience, they need to experience. And that's up to them and not up to us to judge that or to make those changes for them, because they have to do it themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's that thing where we have to be aware all the time, be awake and paying attention, because it's very easy. There's the psychology behind the rhetoric, and it's going on right under our noses. But if you are lulled to sleep, you're not paying attention, so you don't even hear it. It becomes a part of your everyday life. So staying aware, staying on top of things, so that we don't get pulled into things that we don't want to be a part of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well said, because one thing little notes I've written down here to think of it this way, and some of that, the psychology that's going on, I mentioned cancel culture. I'm not going to get political on this. Did I say cancel correctly? Because I said cancer culture. So anyway, it's another way of saying it. But think of it this way. What is happening now, think of it as, is that giving us freedom? Is that giving us sovereignty? Because we are sovereign beings, and each of us is unique. And so how much freedom do you feel with some of the stuff that's going on? Is that truly going to give us our freedom?
Yeah, we see stuff going on outside of ourselves so that we can understand what's going on within ourselves. So when we're seeing it so strongly outside, that's a cue. Look inside, because there's something that needs a little work here. Mm-hmm. You know, use your creative imagination. Make yourself into what you really want to be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there's no accidents, as we know. So, Bev, when you were saying cancer culture, that's exactly what it describes it very, very well. What is a cancer? Cancer multiplies. It just keeps growing and growing and growing, and it takes over the organism and destroys it. Well, basically, that's what this cancer culture is. It's just getting out of hand. It's going outrageous, ridiculous things that are happening. And, unless we take and get a hold of it and let our voice know, it will destroy us. You know, it'll dichotomy, and it'll pull us apart, and we don't need to be pulled apart. We need to be joined together in light, love, and truth.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I was just thinking of it's the snake eating its tail type thing, even with the cancer culture or cancer culture, whatever terminology you want to use. It's that, I see it imploding because it just can't hold up.
Yeah.
Because it gets to the utter ridiculousness.
Until it cancels itself out.
There you go.
Right.
So the cancer culture cancels itself out.
Yeah.
So it's like eating its tail. It's not, it's not going to go that far, but it gives us the opportunity to look within ourselves and what is truth for us. Mm-hmm. And, and connect with our feelings, connect with all the experiences with that we've had in this life, as well as other lives, come up to look at, and release, or understand what it's like to be in the physical human body. All of these things is like why we're here and why we're even incarnated into the physical body. And most of us from, you know, other dimensions, so to speak, because we reside on in many dimensional levels, but in this body, you know, we're merging with those other dimensions. And so we're starting to see all these things that we have done as beings in various vessels. And like last week, or excuse me, 2 weeks ago, Terry, last episode, you talked about the cups, and each cup was a different color. And so, and we're all out of the same ocean, right? And so we may have been a yellow cup in a past life, so-called past life, and we may want to be a red cup this time. You talked about, you know, changing the stars or whatever. And then, or we merge the two cups together and we're in an orange cup. You know, so, you know, it's just a way of looking at life and the diverseness that we have chosen and experience together as one. It's really phenomenal when you look at it that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I had a thought that came to me during meditation one day this week. And that the reason we're here, we chose to be here, but the reason we here or keep coming back, but is to finally awake and recognize that we're using a vehicle, we're using the cups, we're not that cup, we're not that vehicle, we are the essence inside it. It just was real clear that as you start to come to evolve and you are ready to awaken to the truth, it comes to you, you know. And that's basically what the four of us are doing now. We have somewhat of awakened in our own realms, and we're just sharing that awakenedness, that knowingness with the audience that chooses to listen to, that chooses to maybe awaken for themselves. And it's really a neat process. And another thing, it doesn't matter who you were, what you did, how many lives you've lived in the past, because as you come into this life, all of those experiences have been focused, laser focused into this incarnation and this experience, and you chose it for a reason. So the most important time, not what happened before, not what's going to happen in the future, but what's happening right now in this moment. And then you have a choice every moment, every second, to choose what you want to manifest, what you want to be. And regardless of what you think you might have done or you think what will happen in the future, stay focused now. And your inner being will tell you moment by moment what the right thing to do. And you'll know every time.
Mm-hmm. Well said, Terry. Thank you. Exactly. Yeah, right now is the most important time ever. That can go forward and or what we term forward or backwards in our linearity. But yeah, exactly. And, you know, to say we were this great person, or we did this, we did that. I mean, I've got memories of all kinds of things, and some of those lives I'm not sure if I want to repeat. I don't want to really repeat any of them, but you know, some of them I wanted to understand what it was like to be in a hardship, so-called hardship, and other ones I've, you know, worked in healing centers or whatever it may be. So it's just interesting, though, how we can bring some of those aspects of ourselves into this physical life to understand ourselves more fully in this now.
And something that has been drawn to my attention specifically today was that if you need help, ask for it. Because being where we are, the planet Earth, and this time frame, there is the freedom of choice, freedom of will, and if we don't ask for help, we're not going to get it, because it's hands off until we ask. Mm-hmm. So don't go expecting that somebody's going to drop down out of the sky and fix it, take care of you. You have to ask first.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of people are saying, okay, I want that savior, or they know I need help. Why don't they just help out?
Mm-hmm.
And if you're going through something, and some people get mad because they're not helping out, and well, they should know better type of thing. And of course, what is that, a judgment? And so, yeah, and it's like, well, did you ask? This is free will. No. Well, duh. You know,
yeah. And don't expect people to have their crystal balls in front of them, because sometimes they're just totally oblivious. It's not that they don't care or mm-hmm. or anything. They just missed it. So ask mm-hmm. for help, whether it's of other fellow human beings or whether you need a little bit higher help. Mm-hmm. Ask for it.
Yeah. Yeah. So many beings are out there. Our team, our family out there that are watching out over us, and they do need us to ask, and they want us to ask. That's what they're there for. So,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of times we get real independent feeling, I can do this myself, like mm-hmm. we were talking about earlier. And it's true. I mean, we're meant to be self-empowered, but there's also a team that's working together. Just like on the earth, we have our team out there. So we can honor that and respect that and call on it. And it really does make a difference, because we are a team. None of us stand totally alone here.
Mm-hmm.
It's a delicate balance between getting that self-independence and empowerment, mm-hmm. but, you know, working with the team. And that's what it takes.
Well, again, the more we help ourselves, we help even those, our fellow human beings, as well as the other beings.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, our space, if you want to call them space brothers and sisters. And so remember, we're helping ourselves as well as them. We're all in this together.
Yeah.
I don't care if you're on Earth or not. Mm-hmm. But we came here, and this is such an interesting time going through. We haven't really talked about this, 26,000-year cycles. Now that puts a little linearity in there. Mm-hmm. But it's a way for us to understand the point of where we're at right now, and we're taking the Earth into the golden age.
Yeah.
So
the 26,000 years, that ties into the sun solar cycle, and so you say the golden age, that's the sun, everything under the sun.
Good way of putting that. Thank you. Wow. Yeah. So mm-hmm. always ask. And, we're not an island all by ourselves. And some people may think that. Also, when you're thinking about either your fellow human beings or the space brothers and sisters, there's no savior out there that's going to save you. You're your own savior. But again, you can work together. So some people are still waiting for intervention and that sort of thing. And you know, I think we've had some intervention on Earth if nuclear missiles go off, that will not be allowed anymore, or atomic mm-hmm. bomb type thing, because it messes up not only
not
the Earth.
Not us.
Yeah. So that's going on and being dealt with. So and a lot of beings are, been here and trying to maneuver us into a little darkness. And it's like, we're not doing that. So that's why, we're in such an empowerment time, and for us to be aware and awake, and the so-called psychology going on, it's not going to work unless we want it to, but realize that we are our own saviors.
Mm-hmm. Wake up.
Yeah, wake up. And our planet's getting to the point, I feel, since our planet is ascending and our planet's a being, that, and the energy is increasing so much, that people are creating their choices right now, where they're going to go and where they're going to be when the great, divide happens, the great split, like the frequency shift. It'll be like all of a sudden is what I keep seeing, and from other people I share with or they share with me, that, see, it's like everything's building up so strongly, and it'll get to a point at some point where the frequencies just shift, and then mm-hmm. we're either with the super high frequency new civilization, so to speak, that we really know, or we are left behind, so to speak, to develop somewhere else, that's three-dimensional, and that's all okay, too. We all have our choice. It's all free will. Mm-hmm. So there's no judgment or anything, but it's like, where do you want to be? Where do we want to be? We decide it by our thoughts and emotions, what emotions we concentrate on. And are we letting go and flowing like a river, or are we hanging on to past junk? So let go of the mud and swim and float on the river and have a good time.
Where we're, I'm going to use the word developing, a new way to be in the physical. And so, you know, Terry, you mentioned the vessels of the cups, and, maybe we can be in a whole different type of vessel, whatever you want it to be.
Luminous.
There we go.
We're getting more and more luminous all the time. Yes, absolutely.
Homo luminous.
Yeah.
What does homo mean?
One,
right? Illuminated one.
Mm-hmm.
And that's us. So really listen to that and really realize that it is us that are being illuminated or illuminating ourselves. And we're in charge, guys.
Yeah, we absolutely
are. Yeah. So any more comments on that? Because I want to go to one more subject. Terry?
Go for it.
All right. Animal communication came up today. And we had a little special dog here today, very sweet little dog. And we did a meditation, and the dog was just quiet as can be, and his own world too, and staying near one of us, actually Donna, and just and being in her energetic field. And it's just interesting to watch the animals because they work on so many levels. I actually, Miss Royce here call her an animal whisperer, because she can communicate with the animals, and I think you do too, Donna. So I'm going to let you two talk about that, then Terry, you can join in.
Yeah, it's a sad thing to see when people, in my eyes, cut the animals short, because they are sentient beings. They are so awake. Some of them have been mistreated to a point to where they act vicious and stuff, but they're responding to how they've been treated. And some of them have had that trait brought out in their behavior. But the animals are just, oh man, if you'll just take the time to watch the animals, they can teach you so much in being one with the planet and not taking it for granted, and the interactions with people. Oh, but do you have anything to add into that? Because they're just so special.
Yeah. And today, since we did the meditation and I felt this dog, Robbie, beside me and his energy, I knew he was supposed to be a part of the meditation. I kept seeing him lay a certain direction, but and he was kind of laid that direction, but over by me the way it turned out. And it reminded me, because like his the lady who watches over him, I don't want to say owner,
companion.
But his companion, mm-hmm. Nancy, mentioned that he was just so quiet because he was literally in an altered state with us.
Yeah.
And it reminded me of when I've had different cats along the way, different places I've lived, and when I would go out of body to do things to help the planet, there were different cases. Like one cat where I lived in Maine would hop up on the dresser. I was sleeping on the bed, and she would just go out with me at the very same time. And if I went into the bed, she'd come in with me and get on the dresser if it's in the middle of the day or something. And I could be out like an hour, and like clockwork, she would just come right back in. Her soul would just enter back in. We'd wake up together and look at each other, like in a dead stare, like, okay, thank you. And I thanked her for going out and helping, And so anyway, the cats are also placeholders and energy holders, and they see so much on so many levels, way more than we realize.
And they appreciate so much when you recognize them and talk to them instead of just ordering them around.
Yes.
I've had this one dog that was close to me. I was talking to his companion, and the dog held it as long as he could, and he just couldn't hold it any longer, and he jumped up on the fence. I could hear him clear as a bell. He said, "Oh, I love you." And so I hugged him, and then I said, "Now you need to get down because you're not supposed to be up on the fence." But he just because I talk to the dogs, you know, I talk to them, and they can pick up on the pictures that you're holding in your mind, the feelings that you have. If your feelings are hurt, if you're angry, they pick up on all of that, and some of them take on this stuff themselves and try to transmute the energy for you. And a lot of them will do that to the point of their undoing because they're so unselfish. They'll take it all if they can. They're just truly giving beings, precious beings here with us, not for us.
Yeah, right. Oh, you mentioned about the visualization. And so if you're with an animal and you want to tell them that, they react to visions. Mm-hmm. And so you can project those visions to them and they will understand that. Mm-hmm. And they actually understand quite a few words, as you heard, "I love you." Mm-hmm. And you may not audibly hear that, or you may. Not everybody's going to audibly hear that, but those animals know words, and some of them can actually speak that.
Well, I think their thoughts are we receive it translated into English or whatever language we're used to hearing.
Yeah.
But I think the thoughts are translated, you know,
to us.
Yeah, so it doesn't really matter whether they understand English per se. They transfer, they put their thoughts out there, and then we receive it. And that, I think that's where the translation takes place, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and some of them actually do speak English. I mean, like we've heard that, "I love you." I heard that from a little, you know, pug dog that says, "I love you" every morning to his companion, my friend. So they actually, and I've heard of some golden retrievers that actually talk, you know, to their one fellow I knew. His golden retrievers talk to him in English, in certain words, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it is, it's telepathic, and yeah, they are so amazing. I went on a trip when I was living in Arizona. We had this little chihuahua, the most beautiful little being, two of them actually. And the one that I was super connected to, she knew, evidently. I kept telling my friends that I've just got to be where it's greener, because this is in the Sedona Desert.
Mm-hmm.
And and of course, she always didn't like it when I left. And when I get home, she would just be so happy, and jumping all over me. And one time she came to me in a dream when I was over in California, and she's all wrapped in vines. She's got all these big, like, Philadelphia, or what do you call that?
Philodendron.
Yeah. All these plants wound up around her, like, "I'm in the green. Come home. It's green. You know, I'm in the green. Come and see." And I get back, and she's like, and a lot of trauma had happened in the neighborhood with some of these people there, including in that house. And so she's like, you know, jumps up on me, pick her up, take her out to the little swinging bench, you know, on the patio back there, and she's like talking for 10 minutes, like just unloading all this stuff, telling me everything that happened. And she was so wound up. When she got done, she just like caved in and like took some breaths out, and just, she was wiped out from telling me everything.
Wow.
But she knew I'd listened to her.
Yeah.
And she ended up dying early, and I know it's because of, she was so sensitive to people's
taking
stress,
on.
You know?
Yeah.
And other things went on, and whatever. But, and then, of course, we know these animal rescue stories where the animals find people uncannily, you know, like, how do they find them so far away, that kind of thing.
Yeah, clear across the country.
Yeah.
Taking months.
Go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there's that connectiveness.
Yeah.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the animals, the elephants that came in before that great big tsunami a few years ago, they took pictures of the elephants that came in, and they were getting people on their backs that were on the beach before anybody even knew the tsunami was coming. and they were taking them to higher ground.
Wow.
The elephants knew, and they came and got the people on their backs.
Yeah.
That would come with them.
Amazing.
Hmm. You know, we really live in an amazing world.
Yeah, we do.
I mean, you know, look at everything. I mean, all the life that goes on here. And the bird kingdom is very interesting, too. Yeah. They're very sentient. I think we did talk about that on another episode, but go ahead.
Well, what came to mind was when I try to mimic their precious little songs, and I'll just be making an attempt, and I feel like they recognize that I'm really trying hard, and it's like I hear this little laugh, and then they start off one note at a time, note, and I'll repeat the note, and then they'll do two notes, the first note and the second note, and I'll do that. So they're very patient, trying to teach me how to do it right. If you want to be a bird,
you got to do it right.
And of course, the dolphins and whales. And all the sea creatures, they're really helping us.
They work the ley lines, they work, you know, energy, especially the dolphins. I've been pretty close to the dolphins in some of the whales, but that's a whole amazing adventure. Those from Sirius, maybe Pleiades, but here to help with the changes going on the earth. So,
and some of the animals are not animals at all. I have been blessed to have several of those come to be with me. There was one when he was reaching the end of his time here. I was still asleep, and I was awakened hearing a male's voice say, "Well, here I am, standing right beside you." And I opened my eyes, and there was my beloved doggy just staring me in the eyes. And after this sweet being passed, I saw him in vision, and he was gorgeous. And he was not in an animal suit. He was in what we would refer to as a master suit. And he had his robe and this beautiful light shining behind him. So you just never know what's behind those precious little eyes looking back at you.
So, Terry, you've been quiet. Do you have anything to add to our conversation?
Well, it's interesting. I my experience with animals is not quite like you ladies and stuff, but two visions came to me. First of all, for some reason, out of the blue, in February, I got the feeling, okay, it's time that you don't eat any animals at all. Oh. So since March 1st, I haven't had any animal meat, fish meat, anything that really breathes air, just vegetables and fruit, which replenish themselves. You don't kill the tree to get the fruit, and the vegetables you grow, and you can grow more. So, but a thought came to me, well, why am I doing that, you know? It just came to me. And then I'm thinking about Daniel in the Bible and the lions. And there's a cute commercial. I don't know if it's a Geico commercial, or it's just two antelopes, you know, sitting there. And I think I don't know if it's a lion or a tiger or something. He's across there. And the one antelope goes to the other one, "What are we going to do?" And he goes, "I'm just going to run." He goes, "Well, what, you know, how fast are you going to run?" He goes, "I just have to be faster than you." My thought was, if I'm, you know, if something was to transpire in the world, and I'm with another friend of mine, or just another person, and we're in the wild, and an animal comes up and looks at us, I'm going to know that animal is going to sense he doesn't eat meat. He's not going to eat me or harm me. Ah, that other person does. So you ladies have kind of given an argument for vegetarianism, just as a final note.
Uh-huh. Well, I think...
Remember, I just have to outrun you.
I think Mr. Rogers, when he was questioned about being a vegetarian, he said, I just can't bring myself to eat anything that has a mother.
There you go. Well, I think that wraps it up for tonight. Donna, I don't know how long you'll be with us, but I'm glad you're back here and giving us your presence and your experience. And I look forward to seeing you next week with if you're still here to tell me about your travels and what's new. Royce and Bev, it's always good to have you with us. Hopefully we'll meet again next week and prepare for the following week, which our next show will be on Tuesday, April 20th at 7 p.m. So with that, ladies, say good night, and we'll call it a wrap. Jack.
Good night, everybody. Thank you, Terry.
Good night. Thank you for joining us this evening. Those that listen, any comments, of course, are welcome, but we appreciate your listening to what we have to share, because we love to share it all, and it opens doors for the listeners, for us, that opens other doors. And you know how that goes, that ripple effect to help awaken people up to who they are.
And please know that I love you and thank you for staying.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.
Bonsoir.